Thank you. Questions in from the Tetbury, Goodshed and Gloucestershire representatives, Alex Forsyth, the producer was Robin Moore, and the lead engineer was Tim. There's a chance to share your views on the analysis now on the podcast 700-100-4-4-4. That's podcast 700-100-4-4-4.
Yeah. religious, no man yells, or who says to listen to a creed of belief and expression. Have you been told to take something off? Have you maybe done the term? A star shape of the century around the civil service, and I just wonder if people have been wider in society, how this will exactly be successful. 03700 text 84844, text the charge to the sound of the situation. Or you can tweet us on X-Sister3, hashtag BBCDQ. Let's start with the thing that you most want to talk about, though, and that is how schools should be teaching sex education. Our first caller on this is Yvonne Buckley, who's calling us from Ipswich. Hello. Welcome. Thanks for being our first caller. So what do you think the guidelines should be, and what did you make from the government?
I've been out of school for a very long time. I went to school in 1959, and I was told by my parents and family members about infertile country here or there that you should tell somebody, and I was 4 years old. So I think children should be told, if it's not your child, it's not your child that's the problem, it's other people's children. People are teaching their children, watching PG films, under PG films, under age films, and over age films, and teaching their children rubbish and guns and knives and things like this. It's not pulling their ribbon anymore, it's pulling their bra. It's worse than having schools now. So you should teach your children more. And gay rules. They should have a right to know about the gay laws, because people coming into school with two parents of the same sex, you know, should be taught about that.
So let's separate these things, because on the one hand, Tim Montgomery, said, if they don't do something radical, say, to protect our children in this culture, what we are doing, we just do not know. They are losing their childhood, they are losing their innocence. What did you make of that?
Well, the first is that people, the children are picking up their mother's phone from the age of, one, so they can see anything. They're looking, they can see anything that they're not understanding or not probably understanding swear words or things like that. So I think you said about the phone, you went on to say about the phone, something about the phone. And things like that. So I think children should be taught about sex education in school by their teachers, parents and guardians.
And when Gillian Keegan, who is the education secretary, she said a big secret, that's not really possible, but she said biological sex is the basis of relationship, sex and health education. These are much contested views. So I mean, should these things always be linked together? If you know what, if you're in a relationship, this is what could happen.
I don't know what these parents are afraid of waiting till 9 to teach their children. They're not even walking out by themselves and going to the shops by themselves. So I don't know why they're waiting for the age of 9 to explain to their children that there's nothing else out there. We had seen a park outside our school when I was younger. And you should know what to do rather than stuff like that with a teacher. I think you should be sexually aware. I think children should be sexually aware.
Yvonne, very great people. Thank you very much indeed. 03700 100444. This has generated a lot of interest this afternoon. We have just been in touch on email. Some primary schools use materials that are not age appropriate. Some pursuing inappropriate LGBTQ+ and journalism. Parents have a right to know what children are being taught. And the government guidance is very welcome, says Bill. Ruth says, I'd be interested to see this questionable material on gender. The government have apparently seen being taught in schools. No one seems to have been able to give any evidence of this. It's just been another manufactured culture. Let's take another call on this. Roseanne is calling us. Norfolk. Hi, Roseanne.
Hi, Ruth.
Well, what did you want to say?
I learned about sex in biology lessons in a factual way in school in the 1960s, and that XY represents the male, sex represents the female. You can't change that no matter what you really want. Also, I see that culture is now very sexist and ugly results. So that was theory about sex whenever I turn on the BBC and other media, which just raised a lot of attention to the point which we got.
So, can I just ask you what age? Because I don't know how it was in the 60s, but certainly when I was at school. So in the 80s, biology really only kicked in at secondary school. I didn't really do it in the primary school.
Yeah, that's absolutely right.
So would that be the way you think that is quick? It's really interesting, because I think you went to school at the same time as somebody else called Anne, who has emailed me on the programme. And I think you would have been contemporaries at school, just age-wise, if not area-wise. She says, look, I have no children, but I was once a child. I believe children need age-appropriate knowledge to help arm them against sexual abuse. In 1959 and 1960, I was a 5 or 6 year old child, and I was befriended by an older girl who lived nearby and went to the same primary school. With hindsight, I now recognise that the name was conception. So after school, she took me to meet a couple of boys in Wasteland. Although she stripped me, my memory is of a sexual act occurred between her and the boys, no reflection. I think they didn't know what to do. I believe that nowadays, boys of that age would be far more likely to know what to do. I mean, with that kind of memory of that going on in the 60s, was it not a disservice not to tell children like Anne that, you know, this is what this is?
I think
you don't need it and don't want it, and this is what you do about it.
Yeah, I think that's the job of parents rather than schools, I can't see, when they're very young. I mean, that's the sort of thing that my parents would have taught me. You know, that it doesn't need to be taught to very young children in schools. It can be taught by parents. And if the parents don't know what to do, they ought to be the ones being taught what to do and how to handle it.
But if you don't believe in the information that we've given, but you do disagree that teachers should do the giving of information, I just wonder why you don't think teachers ought to be, you know, since they spend such a lot of time, sometimes more time than parents, just because of the school day, the architecture of the school day, why it shouldn't be them who disseminate this kind of information.
Well, I think the parents are the ones who know and love their children best. And hopefully have their best interests at heart, and they would be more interested than the teacher in what it's doing to their children, so they could handle it far more sensitively. And I myself have had children brought up in the later on, because I got married quite late, and I didn't like the sort of sex education that was being given to my children either. I do think it's parents' responsibility, and if they don't know how to handle it, they should be the ones being taught how to handle it.
Roseanne, thank you very much for your call. 03700 100 444. And I'm really, really, really interested in this. And if you're a teacher or you are a parent, let me know what you think about this. Should schools be teaching sex education? What should they be teaching in sex education? Do you agree that nothing should be taught under the age of 9 to safeguard the innocence of childhood? I think that was a phrase that Tim Montgomery used. And should there be nothing about gender identity at all? Or is this actually the responsibility of caregivers and teachers that, you know, if that's who they spend a lot of time with, maybe most of the time in the week, they ought to be the first port of call because they'll recognise if something is needed? 03700 100 444. Kerry Williams, calling us from Norwich, listening patiently. Hi, Kerry.
Yeah. Hello.
Hi, welcome. So tell me what you think.
Well, my view comes from my experience of volunteering at Bedlam Primary School in Norwich. And from what I've seen, it was a brilliant school with excellent teachers. And I would place my trust in their wisdom in dealing with what are very sensitive issues, rather than in requirements imposed by this government for what appear to be political ends.
Moving away from that particular school, but just schools in general, you heard our previous caller say, look, this should be down to the parents. It should be their choice what their child learns. That choice, that duty, ought not to be taken out of parents' hands and given to a school and teachers who, in her words, you know, do not love a child like a parent loves a child.
I don't think I would agree with that, because you can get very approaches, different approaches from different parents, and you wouldn't guarantee that children would have the knowledge that they need as they're growing up.
can I read something out to you from a teacher who says, I wish to remain anonymous, and if that's fine, I'll respect that. I'm a supply teacher in secondary schools in the north of England. There are LGBT clubs for LGBT and allies at lunchtime run by teachers. Lesson plans which conflate non-conformity to sex stereotypes and with being transgender are very common. There is a climate of fear and staff are afraid to challenge this ideology. So again, sort of suggesting that this is not, you know, this varies according to from school to school and teacher to teacher and what somebody thinks is the normal and what somebody thinks is not the normal.
Yes. I think one of the points that was made by some young panel was the lack of evidence backing up what the government are proposing to do on this. And I would really like to see some systematic evidence for whether there really are widespread problems on this issue.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. 0371 100 444. Caroline is emailing the programme today. As a retired community paediatrician and in the wake of the CAS report on gender identity in children, I think it's entirely appropriate that the government has raised this extremely important issue. Parents are rightly concerned. Let's take another call on this. Dr. Madeline Yates is calling this from Leeds. And there are two things really going on here, Dr. Yates. On the one hand, there is it appropriate for young children to find out about sex at school under the age of 9, or should that be up to parents? And on the other hand, should there be any kind of lessons about LGBTQ plus issues in school? Is that the place to learn about these things? Can you tell me what you think?
Hi, thank you for having me on. I work at the moment in the doctorate of obstetrics and gynaecology. I'm married to a teacher. And between us, we have a three-year-old son. In my experience at work, I have young people coming to me who don't fully understand their bodies. They don't fully understand how reproduction works and how they can age. And I believe that that puts people at risk. And unfortunately, I see people very young in that group, you know, in their early teens. And I worry because I know that the sex education that I received at school was inadequate for me. I've obviously learned a lot about it since. I've seen this next generation come through, and like I say, I have a three-year-old son, so what is it going to be like for him? I have already started to teach him about his anatomy and how that works. He has a penis and a scrotum rather than any other terms that might be used. I have told him about my anatomy, and you know, when I have my menstrual cycle, he has asked questions, and so I've answered those honestly with appropriate terms. I want to teach him about Jesus' consent. I already have started doing that. He has his own personal boundaries, and I have my personal boundaries. And I think by leaving this out of the curriculum until beyond the age of 9, for a lot of people, for a lot of young girls and people with uteruses, they may start their menstrual cycles at an earlier age than that. So we are doing them a disservice, we are putting people at risk from both unplanned pregnancy, from abuse. You know, the UNFPCC has been really clear that sex education and knowledge is power, it can reduce the risk of abuse. And people are saying we should be left to the parents, but as Jan agreed with one of the previous callers, saying that will create a patchy knowledge amongst our population. Whereas if we have it done, you know, as a curriculum, standardised in education by teachers, then that will be delivered equally to all children and young people.
So, I mean, is this, when you talked about when you went to school, you said it was
back in the 90s of the early noughties.
Right, okay. So, I mean, then I suppose it's more analogous to what our children are growing up with now, because, I mean, certainly not to the extent, but there was, you know, our callers and our contributors who grew up in the 1960s, they didn't have the internet. They didn't have smartphone usage and the availability of that. Has there been a change in the age appropriateness of teaching sex education from the time you went to school, even in the 90s, and now?
Yeah, I absolutely think so, because I've seen that, you know, I think, what was it, 25% of 5 to 7 year olds have a smartphone. And so those children are going to be at risk of viewing unwanted content, unwanted, possibly sexual content. You know, social media and have all of these algorithms, and it is showing children material that a lot of people would deem inappropriate for a 5, 6 or 7 year old. So if they view that material and if they're not educated on it, you know, so if it's pornography, for example, that is their only exposure. Whereas they need somewhere safe and they need somewhere that where they're going to get evidence-based, supportive information to keep them safe. We, you know, I feel like I'm trying to be as switched on as possible when it comes to technology and my child, but I'm so aware that he is likely to be exposed to stuff from a young age that I don't know about or that I can't protect him from. But I want him to have a safe space to be able to ask questions.
Right.
To know that pornography, for example, isn't real. That's not what the healthy sexual relationships are. So he can learn what is actually real, what is my body, what does it do, what are other people's bodies, what do those people's bodies do. Rather than get, I want him to be able to get that from a reliable source. I feel, I'm a gynecologist working as a teacher. My son will hopefully get reasonable information from us, but it would be great if all children could get that reasonable information from a reliable source, such as a teacher. And like I say, 25% of 5 to 7 year olds have a smartphone.
I completely hear you, and I've also, I see the prevalence of smartphones. But is David Johnson, who was the Minister of State for Children, Families and Wellbeing, right when he says, this is the world that we live in, but then there is a counterbalance, perhaps, and that is the duty of schools. And what he said was, a very good example of this is that in primary schools, as the guidance proposes at the moment, you would teach about conception and healthy relationships in the broadest sense, but you wouldn't teach anything about explicit sex education. That only comes in year 9.
I don't think that's right. I think the more knowledge is power, the more information. Obviously, it has to be taught in a way that a young child can understand. But you don't, it's like with math. You introduce the simple math concepts at an early age. You would introduce decimals and fractions. And then as they get older, you make it more complex. So it has to be age appropriate in the way that it's delivered, but the content can still be there.
Okay. Thank you very much for your call. 03700 100 444. It's all lighting up this afternoon. Libby Bowles has been in touch. Sex education of any sort should not be taught in primary schools at all. It's down to the parents to tell their children what they need to know. As for LGBT and gender awareness, that is totally inappropriate. Julia in Buckinghamshire has been in touch. She says, in 1983, at the height of the AIDS epidemic, my grammar school taught me about condoms. My mum was cross because she thought they were encouraging me to have sex. My school might have saved my life, says Julie. Lucy in Durham says, as a parent of 2 girls, 8 and 12, and as a secondary school teacher, I think it's really important to discuss sex and relationships in an age-appropriate way. Banning the discussions by under-9s is a really bad idea. Let's take another call on this. Philippa East is calling us from Lincolnshire. Good afternoon, Philippa.
Hi, good afternoon, Anita.
Hello, welcome to the programme. Thank you for calling us. What did you want to say?
So my points are specifically about the advice in the draft statutory guidance about the teaching about gender reassignment and gender identity. So specifically two things. One is that at the start of that section, the guidance says pupils should be taught the law about gender reassignment. Schools should be clear that an individual must be 18 before they can legally reassign their gender. Sadly, that's a of UK law.
You just drifted away a little bit. So just start again. You said it's a serious misrepresentation of, and then you kind of.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Go on.
It's just a serious misrepresentation of UK law. Actually, it's conflating the protected characteristic of gender reassignment in the Equality Act, which has no age limit on it and applies to adults and children, that includes school pupils, with a completely separate piece of legislation around obtaining a gender recognition certificate under the Gender Recognition Act, which is only for age 18 and over. And I think it's extremely concerning that in this published draft statutory guidance, the Department of Education have made such a misleading statement to suggest that gender reassignment has nothing to do with children, and that's just a complete misrepresentation of the fact.
Okay, well, what about those, and there have been a few who have said in the programme saying there is a difference between sex education and gender identification, because one is, one is a fact and the other one is an ideology. What would you say about that?
Yeah, well, it's really interesting But again, the guidance goes on to say that specifically gender identity can't be taught at all. First of all, I think it's, again, an unusual position to take, given that children will be coming across discussions about gender identity. The winner of this year's Eurovision is a non-binary person. So again, it's a general principle of having a safe space, another caller has said, for children to learn responsibly about what they're encountering in the world. I think to ban any form of teaching about it is strange. And they go on to give two justifications, both of which I think are at best rather bizarre. So the first justification is that gender identity is highly contested and complex. But in their own draft statutory guidance, they then go on to explain the topic really clearly and in a really balanced way. So they specifically say, it's a sense the person may have of their own gender, whether male, female, or a number of other categories. This may or may not be the same as their biological sex. Many people do not consider that they or others have a separate gender identity. Now, these are the Department for Education's own words, and I don't think there's anything they're saying that is hugely controversial, and I don't see why they can't advise people to teach along those lines. The second justification, sorry, just one more point.
Yeah, David, actually, very briefly, it's just that your voice keeps drifting in and out, so if you could, just
sorry,
don't worry. It's like you're on a boat, and you're circling. Oh. Do carry on.
The second justification that they give, again, I think is quite concerning. So again, in their consultation survey, they make this statement about teaching gender identity. Along with other factors, discussing such theories with pupils could prompt some pupils to start to question their gender. And I think that implies one of two things. One is that simply by teaching children information, you can incorrectly get them to think wrong about themselves, that they misunderstood their own self, or the idea that if they are learning about this, the idea that they might want to explore themselves or understand their own identity in a new way, that is inherently bad. And I think you can place the term gender identity in that statement and say discussing theories of sexual orientation with people could prompt some pupils to start to question their own sexuality. I think we immediately hear how bizarre that sounds, to suggest that teaching people about sexual orientation could unduly influence their own understanding of themselves, or that teaching about this and then a pupil going on to explore their own identity and orientation is somehow a bad thing. So I think there's a real political agenda driving these recommendations around gender identity.
Okay. Andrew, thank you very much for your call. 03700 100 444. This one anonymous. I'm a teacher. I'm furious about the new guidelines. Our children simply won't understand what corrupt people are doing to them unless the conversation is being held with the children about what sex is safe, controlled and responsible. Julie says, there was no sex education at my primary school in the 1950s. My introduction to the subject came from playground jokes, and I really wish I'd learnt about sex in the classroom rather than the playground. Let's take another call. Andrea from East London. Hi, Andrea.
Hello,
Andrea. Thanks for calling. What did you want to say?
I think a lot of people don't realise that gender identity is being taught as fact in primary schools. A lot of people, they trust their head teachers, that's great. But a lot of things are going on in some primary schools that I think parents would be shocked by. I certainly was. So both of the primary schools my daughter has been at have presented gender ideology as fact. Now, I don't share the belief in gender identity, I just don't. There are men and women, and they come in a whole glorious range of diversity, effeminate men, masculine women. Wonderful, absolutely wonderful. This idea that you have a gender is contested. Lots of people don't believe in it. We think it's just stereotypes. And that's really harmful to teach to children as fact that boys who are a particular way are actually girls. And even worse than that, we're not teaching them at a really young age that they have to participate in those beliefs. We don't do this for any other set of beliefs in this country. We teach beliefs in RE, and we don't teach them as facts. But it's happened at both of my daughters' school. The deputy head of her primary came in and told her, age 9, that a child she knew to be a boy was a girl, and she had to refer to him by a female name and female pronouns. Now, that goes against my protective beliefs. I have protective beliefs in this area. Gender critical beliefs are protected. I then contacted the school. So where is this boy who is now a girl going to the toilet? Where is he changing? They were mixed sex changing at the time because they were young, and it was really uncomfortable because lots of the girls were developing. 8 is a perfectly normal time to start puberty for girls. And I was told, and I have it in writing from the school.
Without naming the school, Andrea.
Not going to name the school, I promise. Yeah. They couldn't separate by sex to change because it might, and I quote, upset or offend the trans and non-binary children. Now, it's important to remember, these children are 9, 8 years old. And these are beliefs that other people have. You shouldn't be expecting.